Shabbat Shalom.
Shabbat Shalom.
You're probably going to be blessed today with perhaps the shortest teaching that I've ever done. Because the Torah portion for this week, it was only 18 verses in the longest portion. The others were shorter than that. And so it's going to be a pretty quick teaching, I think. Again, no questions or comments during the teaching. I want to be talking from Genesis chapter 20 today. I'm going to be talking about Abraham and Abimelech. What I found interesting about this Torah portion this week was the character differences between these two personalities, Abraham and Abimelech. They have a lot of things in common, and they have a lot of things that are very different. Much as you and I would have. We have a lot of things in common, but we have some things that are different. And what will bring us together is our belief in the Torah and the truth of the Torah. And somewhere along the line, we need to come into agreement on the Torah. I've been saying this for years. Why is it that you come here and hear me teach on a Torah portion, and then you go someplace else and hear another teacher teach, and he'll teach on the same Torah portion but completely different? Why is that? I have been saying for many years, what I would like to have is a conference, not where we have praise and worship and all these different teachers. I would like to have a conference whereby the teachers come together and we sit down and we discuss the Torah portions and we say we need to come to a common understanding so that I'm not teaching different than you and you're not teaching different than me. There needs to be that, in my opinion, desperately needs to happen. Whether or not it will, I don't know. But turn with me to Bereshit, Genesis chapter 20, and read along with me. Verse 1. And Abraham set out from there to the land of the south and dwelt between Kadesh and Shur and stayed in Gerar. Abraham departed from Mamre by the terebinth trees. One of the things we have learned and heard many times is the fact that Yahweh doesn't waste words. Everything he says has some significance for us and is part of the plan that he has for us. I want you to look, for instance, at the word Mamre, from Mamre by the terebinth trees. That word Mamre in Hebrew is made up of a mem, a mem, a resh, and an aleph, and the action word, our action meaning for the word, is to fill, to fill something up, to make something full. And the concrete meaning here is first fruits. Now, if you just on the surface think about those two things, he was in Mamre. Something was happening to him while he was there. Some significant things happened to him. One of those things was that he received a blessing of promise. So he was filled with something, and it says that something was first fruits. And so I want you to stay with me. From this understanding, it was here that Abraham was filled with the first fruits, which is the covenant of promise. If you remember, Elohim gave to him and to his seed the promise. And what was that promise? That promise was of an heir that would come. Thank you. It says Abraham came to Kadesh. That word Kadesh in Hebrew means to be consecrated, to be sanctified, to be set apart for a purpose. He dwelt between Kadesh and Shur. Shur means a place of observation. So let's think about that. If we put those together, he consecrated or sanctified or set apart Abraham for a purpose. And Abraham was in a place then where he could observe, he could carefully see the unfolding of Yahweh's plan for him and for his seed after him. And so all these things begin to make sense. Abraham stayed in Gerar to turn aside from the way, is what that city's name means, to turn aside from the way, to tarry or to dwell. Now remember, in Hebrew there's often many meanings to the same word, and so you have to look at the context of the word. Certainly Yahweh was not telling Abraham that he needed to turn aside from the way. How many times does he tell us to make sure we walk in his ways, follow his ways? But it can mean to tarry there, to dwell there. And that is the context. So he was to stay in that place until the appropriate time. You know, we can get way ahead of Yahweh. We get way behind Yahweh. We need to know what his plan for us is. We need to seek him. We need to pray about things before we make decisions, that we understand when he wants us to stay in a place, to be still and know that he is Yahweh, and when he wants us to move, when he intends for us to do something else that is going to cause the bringing forth of the kingdom, if you will. In verse 2, Abraham said concerning Sarah, "She is my sister." And Abimelech, the sovereign of Gerar, sent and took Sarah. Now I want you to know that Abraham lies here. Or did he? Abraham said, "This is my sister." So because he says that she's my sister, Abimelech decides to take her. Now, what does it mean that he took her? Believing Sarah to be Abraham's sister, Abimelech takes her to be part of his harem. Now, if you read carefully, you will probably discover that Abimelech, at this particular time, was really too old to have any physical relationship. So he just took her to be part of his harem. He didn't take her intending to have any type of intercourse with her. I believe that Abimelech at this point was in his 90s. And so we know that that's the case. And it seems like such an innocent thing, doesn't it? If we're looking at it from the perspective of Abimelech, or we're looking at it from the perspective of Abraham, it looks pretty harmless. Abraham just said, "This is my sister." So Abimelech believes that it's okay for him then to take her and make her part of his harem. And it appears to be very innocent. But look at the next verse, verse 3. Elohim came to Abimelech in a dream by night and said to him, "See, you're a dead man because of the woman whom you've taken, for she is a man's wife." Essentially, what he's saying is, you don't know what the Torah has to say about your relationship with another man's wife. Now, it's clear to me that Yahweh is saying here, Elohim is saying here, it's inexcusable. You can make whatever excuse you want to, but you have done this thing. Whether you knew it or you didn't know it is immaterial, you should have not taken her regardless. Okay? All right, but let's look. He says you're a dead man. A dead man does mean somebody that's dead laying in a casket, right? Somebody that's being buried. But it comes from a Hebrew word which is pronounced muth, and it does not necessarily mean someone who's dead and lying in a casket or something like that. It means worthy of death. So actually, he's saying you are worthy of death. See? If I'm worthy of death, the decision may or may not have been made that I am going to die right then. If I'm worthy of death, I can repent, can't I? I can turn from my sin and I can live. But if I don't repent, then I'm truly dead, right? So, worthy of death. Abimelech was not dead. He was worthy of death because of Sarah. If something doesn't transpire, if he doesn't repent, if he doesn't make teshuvah, he doesn't make this right, Yahweh would have killed him. He would have paid the ultimate price for his sin. Look at verse 4. However, Abimelech had not come near her. That means he'd not had any physical relationship with her whatsoever. And he said, Yahweh, would you slay a righteous nation also? Now pay attention to that. What did he just say? He didn't say, would you slay me? Would you slay a man? He said, would you slay a righteous nation? Right? Had Abimelech known Sarah, had he had physical relation, he would have surely died. Abimelech must have considered his entire kingdom to be righteous. I mean, it's evident from that. Now, I want you to stop and think about that. If I pick one single church out here, any body of believers, and I were to say this, are they everyone righteous? What would the answer be? Do you think everybody that goes to church on a Sunday are righteous? Do you think that every Hebrew roots person who goes on Shabbat are righteous? We would like to think so, but the truth of the matter, you have to look at their walk, don't you? We have to take some things into consideration to make that kind of a determination. And beyond that, I can't say whether that person is, quote, saved or not saved. I don't have the authority to do that. What does the word righteous mean? It means zadik in Hebrew. Hebrew means to be straight, to walk a straight path. Now, let's think about this. Do you think that what he's saying is that you need to go out and just pick a straight path through the woods or a straight path through the city? What does he mean, walk a straight path? He's talking about the Torah, walking in the teaching and instructions of Yahweh. That is the straight path, that is the narrow path. And that's what makes us straight. Or by the other route makes us crooked, doesn't it? Was Abimelech really righteous? Did you look into anything about Abimelech to discover, is this man really righteous? Let's look. Abimelech sought to rule over Shechem by eliminating all his opposition. Namely, by killing all the other sons of Gideon. Find that in Judges 9, 1 and 2. All were killed except Gideon's youngest son, Jotham. Abimelech then became the king of Shechem in verse 6. What am I saying? All of the sons of Gideon, one of the sons of Gideon was Abimelech. Abimelech killed all of his brothers except Jotham, so that he could be the king of Shechem. Does that sound like a righteous man? Nope. Somehow it doesn't sound like a very righteous man to me. Sounds like a man who murdered his own brothers to get what he wanted. Verse 5. This is Abimelech speaking. to Elohim. Did he not say to me, she's my sister? And that's exactly what Abraham said to him. He says in continuance, and she, even she herself said, he's my brother. In the integrity of my heart and in the innocence of my hands, I have done this. In other words, how am I supposed to know that she's not his sister? He said she was, and she said that he's her brother. So how am I supposed to know any different? Are you going to kill me and all of my seed because of this? Remember Moses doing something very similar on a couple of occasions earlier? When he pleaded for his people Israel. Abimelech pleads his innocence. What he's saying, it isn't my fault, they made me do it. How did they make him do it? Because they lied, right? They deceived him. Verse 6 says, and Elohim said to him in a dream, yea, I know that you did this in the integrity of your heart, and so I kept you from sinning against me. For this reason, I did not let you touch her. See, Abimelech may have very well wanted to touch her. Now, I want you to think about something. How old was Sarah at this point in her life? She's well into her 90s. Can you imagine having lust for a woman that's in her 90s? Evidently, there's something very different about Sarah and her appearance at that age. There is something there that still makes her desirable to men, even though she is at that age. She's obviously a very beautiful woman, right? From this verse, we see that but for Yahweh's intervening, Abimelech would have sinned. Now, I want you to notice that, because Yahweh says above that in verse 6, I kept you from sinning against me. Notice he didn't say, I kept you from sinning against Abraham. Notice he didn't say, I kept you from sinning against Sarah. Or even, I kept you from sinning against yourself. I kept you from sinning against me. I prevented you from sinning against me. All sin is first and foremost against Yahweh Elohim. We may think we sin against a person, or we commit a sin against ourselves, but it is really a sin against Him, right? Consider this. Had Yahweh not intervened, Abimelech would have polluted the promised seed, and history would have experienced a different outcome. What would have happened if there had been physical relations? He would have defiled the seed. He would have mixed the seed. What do you think would have happened then? We wouldn't have had the promised son. Isaac would not have come along through whom all of the promises would be fulfilled. So, my point in bringing that up. When Yahweh prevents a person from sinning, it's so that his plan can remain undefiled, unpolluted, and he will accomplish his purpose. Verse 7, and now return the man's wife, for he is a prophet, and let him pray for you, and you live. But if you do not return her, know that you shall certainly die, you and all that are yours. You, Abimelech, and all of your descendants, all of your seed after you, will die. You will not live. Notice something, though, that he says about Abraham. He is a prophet. Abraham, a prophet. Here's the first word, or first use of the word, Navi. Navi meaning a prophet, or one who brings forth inner fruit. What is inner fruit? Inner fruit is something we cannot produce ourselves. Inner fruit is something that Yahweh Elohim puts in us. It's an inner fruit from Him. Yahweh tells Abimelech that unless he returns Sarah to Abraham, he will destroy him as well as all that are his. What we need to understand is this expresses Yah's desire to destroy the seed of sin. That is his goal from the foundation of the world through Yahweh, through Yeshua, is to destroy the seed of sin, the seed of the serpent. Verse 8. So Abimelech rose early in the morning and called all his servants and spoke all these words in their hearing. And the men were greatly frightened. How frightened would you be if the Creator of heaven and earth came and said, I'm going to destroy you and all of your descendants? Do you think that might instill some fear in you? I think it would in anyone. Fear is a realm of death. We find that in 2 Timothy chapter 1 and verse 7, that fear is a realm of death. Here it is, 1 Timothy 1:7, for Elohim gave us a spirit not of fear, but of power and of love and of self-control. My question to you is, if Yahweh Elohim does not give you fear, where does it come from? Does fear come from the knowledge of the tree of life? Or does it come from the knowledge of the tree of good and evil? I suggest it comes from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. But I want you to notice the wording in 2 Timothy 1:7. I encourage people, not saying that anybody is dumb or don't pay attention, but I know the habit of man is to read through something very quickly. And when you do, you don't digest what these verses really say. If I read this verse very carefully, it's a very brief, small verse, but it says Elohim did not give us a spirit of fear. But look what he did. He gave us a spirit of power, a spirit of love, and a spirit of self-control. Now, I don't know how many times I have heard Christian people say, God controls my life. The Holy Spirit controls my life. No, they do not. He very clearly says, I give you self-control. You are to choose right. You are to choose good and not evil. You are to choose blessings and not curses. It is up to you. But he has given you the Ruach HaKodesh to help you, to assist you in making the right choices. Okay? So please understand, I've actually heard people who want to blame Yahweh Elohim for the things that occur in their life because they say he's supposed to be in control. Well, if he's in control, why do these things happen? He's not in control of your life. You are. I place before you choices. Good and evil, blessings and curses. But he does add an addendum. He says, choose life that you and your descendants may live. So while he doesn't make the choice for you, he gives you the power and the love to be able to be self-controlled. So let's look a little further at this. Here's the fruit of the realm of death. He says it's a lack of spiritual power. Have you ever seen anybody who claims to have been saved for many, many years, and yet they have zero spiritual power in their life? There's none whatsoever. They're afraid of everything that comes around. They're afraid of every man that comes around. They have fear of everything. No spiritual power to help them overcome. They have the inability to love. They do not know how to love their fellow man. Many, many people are in this category. And it's too bad because it's easy enough to solve. They are troubled emotionally. I just said, God, we speak something into my spirit right then as I was talking. This just happened. I'm not going to call any names. But just recently, we've been looking at part of the life of someone who passed away. And we're trying to make decisions about what was wrong with this individual. Why did this individual keep making the decisions they were making? And I did not know that this individual had been raped several times when she was 5 years old by a family member. She was troubled emotionally. She couldn't love. She had no spiritual power to overcome anything because of that. I wish I had known that. Maybe I could have helped her, but I was not aware. Okay? There exist three very important gifts from the Father. Power comes from the Hebrew word oz, knowing one's position or authority and standing in it. Secondly, to be strengthened and protected from danger. So he says, I give you power. Isn't that the first one he said? When he says, I give you power, he says, I know your position. I know you. You have my authority and stand in it. He says, be strengthened by the knowledge that I am Yahweh Elohim. I am your shield and your high tower. I am here to protect you from all danger. Secondly, love. Ahava, ahava. Ahava. One who is loved. He says, know this, that I love you. Again, I surround you with love. I surround you with compassion. I will watch over you. I'll take care of you. We can overcome whatever happens to us. Number three, self-control. Musar in Hebrew. Musar, interestingly enough, see, if you and I were looking at this in English, what do you think we would come to the conclusion that self-control means? But self-control doesn't mean to him what it means to us in English. He is the Elohim of the Hebrews, right? He says Musar. Musar means a doctrine, instruction, okay? What is he telling us, beloved people? What is he saying to us here? He's saying, I have given you my word. They are the words of life. They are the Torah. They are life to you. They are your doctrine for life. They are your instruction for life. How can I be self-controlled? Because I know who the ultimate power and authority is in my life. I know that He loves me. I know that He desires for me to walk with Him, to talk with Him. When I have problems, talk to Him. If we would learn to do that. Remember, keeping the commandments of Elohim, His teaching and instructions, are the foundational proof of Ahava, love. These are the foundation, or the thing that love is built on, is the commandments. Yeshua HaMashiach tells us this. We've talked about this many times. Yohanan chapter 15, verse 10. If, circle the word if you guard my commands, you shall stay in my love. Even as I have guarded my Father's commands and stay in His love. He's not asking you and me to do anything that He hasn't already done. He says, I keep my Father's commandments and I expect no less of you. And I want you to notice the word if. If you guard His commandments, you will stay in love with Him And if you don't, guess what? We could read that if you do not guard my commandments, you will not stay in my love. See, with that, we don't want to hear, do we? We just think he's going to love us regardless. But he very clearly says, we'll have a love relationship as long as you obey my commandments. And this is not difficult for me. If I had four sons, if my sons, if I told them to do something and they failed to do it, that's rebellion. That's a complete disregard of authority. Okay? When I disregard authority, it is sin. I become a son of disobedience. Right? So, I know what it is because I had my sons disobey me many, many times. Okay? I mean, I'm not unique. This happens to every father that I've ever known of. Okay? We have these things happen. Okay? Disobedience by a child is evidence that child is not showing love towards you. They are doing exactly what Yeshua says here. If my child loves me, he'll do what I tell him to do. If he doesn't do what I tell him to do, it's a sure sign. He doesn't love me. He's not listening to me. He's not paying attention. Okay? Yeshua lays claim to the fact that he kept the Torah commandments, didn't he? He said, I've guarded my Father's commands and I stay in His love. How does He stay in His love? Because He does what the Father told Him. And if you take the time to read Yohanan completely through, you'll discover how many times Yeshua says, the words I speak to you are not my own, they are the Father's. The work that I do is not mine, it's the Father's. Okay? He repeats it many, many times. So we just have to have some understanding. Verse 9, Abimelech called Abraham and said to him, what have you done to us? In what have I sinned against you that you brought on me and on my reign a great sin? You have done matters to me that should not be done. We read that, but I wonder how many of us think about the next question I had here. Have you ever done matters to another person that you should not have done? Did you repent of it? Did you ask to be forgiven? I mean, it's easy to do. Sometimes we don't even mean to do it, but we do it. Abimelech said to Abraham, what did you have in view that you've done this matter? There's another way of putting that. A modern way of expressing it would be, what did you have in mind when you did this to me? What was your intent? What did you hope to gain? What was your goal in doing this? And Abraham said, look at his answer. Abraham said, only because I said to myself, the fear of Elohim is not in this place, and they shall kill me for the sake of my wife. He's actually saying something here that we kind of have to remove some of the bushes that are concealing it, shall I say, what he really says. Because what he's saying is there's no fear of Elohim, meaning they don't know anything about the Torah. They're not following the Torah. And so they have no hesitation to kill me because of Sarah, my wife. Abraham said to himself, notice that, Abraham said to himself, he discounted the power of Yahweh. Mm-hmm. When we decide how we are going to react to something, we do it out of our flesh. When we seek Yahweh through prayer, we're asking Him to speak to us spiritually and that we do it the way He wants it done, not the way we ought to do it. In other words, Abraham was saying that these pagans don't accept the Torah instructions concerning a wife. So they'll kill me for sure. You know what he was exercising here? Fear. Why did he exercise fear here? Because he completely forgot all the things that we were teaching before we got to this place. He allowed fear, a realm of death, to enter into his life. He forgot the power of Elohim. Right? we need to understand, boy, when Yahweh gave me this, it was powerful. I'd love to go to every church in this area and make the statement. We all need to understand that Yahweh is more than a book or a scroll. He's more than the Bible you have laying in front of you. He's more than the scroll that any of the prophets held in their hand. Now I realize those are His words. I realize Yeshua HaMashiach is the living word. But we need to realize when we read our scriptures, it's more than just reading out of a book. We're reading the very voice of the Most High. He is Elohim. Yahweh is the omnipotent Father. Nothing is impossible to Him. Right? Absolutely nothing. Verse 12. And yet she is truly my sister. She is the daughter of my father, but not the daughter of my mother. And she became my wife. Now think about that. Did Abraham really lie? Now I read some comments by Christian commentators on this. And they came up with a half-truth as a whole lie and all of that. But I want you to ask yourselves. He said, she's my sister. Was she really his sister? She is his half-sister. Look, she's the daughter of my father. We have the same father, but different mothers. She's my half-sister. So, if Doris was my half-sister, would it be wrong if I just said, she's my sister, and I leave out half-sister, right? This is what Abraham did. She is my half-sister. Let's continue. Abraham simply left out the term half-sister. And when he said, when Sarah says he's my brother, he's her half-brother. Right? They have the same father. Different mothers. And it came to be when Elohim calls me to wander from my father's house. That's a bad word. I want you to know that. Of all the words that Abraham could have chosen to express this, he used the absolute worst word for wander here. Because it throws doubt on what he's saying. Let me continue. It came to be when Elohim calls me to wander from my father's house that I said to her, this is your kindness that you should do for me. In every place, wherever we go, say of me, he is my brother. So if it is a lie, he just told Sarah to lie also. Now, understand, this wasn't the first time Abraham had lied like this. He also told the same lie in Egypt. Right? Wander. Here is a word he chose in Hebrew. Ta'ah. To go astray due to influence. Now, when I read that on the surface, what is Abraham telling me about Elohim? Elohim caused me to wander from my home, to go astray due to his influence. Right? Did he actually, was Yahweh's intent ever for Abraham to go astray? So you see, wasn't a good choice of words here. There's other choices of words in Hebrew that he could have used that would have been much better. But Yahweh doesn't make mistakes. This word is in there for a reason, right? How is it that Abraham lied twice about Sarah and encouraged Sarah to lie as well, but Yahweh did not correct him? Why did Yahweh not say, well, wait a minute, Abraham, you're lying. You just told a lie. It never says that, right? That is because in our Greco-Roman thinking, we have decided what a lie is and what a lie is not. Okay? Now, if I tell a lie, does that keep me from going into the kingdom? If I were to read from Revelation 21:8, Yahweh Elohim says that all liars' place will be in the lake of fire. Okay? But what does he mean when he says all liars? Right? This is important. What is the one lie that keeps someone out of the kingdom according to Yahweh himself? There's only one lie that keeps you out of the kingdom. Let's look. 1 Yohanan 2:22. Who is the liar except the one denying that Yeshua is the Messiah? This is the anti-Messiah, the one denying the Father and the Son. Now I want you to notice a couple of things here. He's saying, who is the liar? Who is the one that's going to cause himself not to go into the kingdom except the one that denies Yeshua is the Messiah? So if I deny Yeshua as the Messiah, that is the one lie that keeps me out of the kingdom. But again, look at the rest of it. This is the anti-Messiah, the one denying what? The Father and the Son. So if I say that Yeshua is not the Messiah, I just denied Yeshua the Messiah and the Father. How could I do that? Because they're one. Right? I mean, this evidence is all over Scripture if people would just slow down and study. Verse 14. Then Abimelech took sheep and cattle and male and female servants and gave them to Abraham. And he returned Sarah, his wife, to him. And Abimelech said, see, my land is before you. Dwell wherever it is good in your eyes. And to Sarah, listen to what he says to Sarah. See, I have given your brother 1,000 pieces of silver. See, it is to you a covering of eyes before all who are with you and before all others. And you are cleared before everyone. What did he just do there? If you study, you realize he paid a redemption price for Sarah to clear her name. Abimelech released Sarah and paid the price necessary to restore her before the people. He didn't do this as a good deed for Abraham. He did it because of Sarah, right? Mm-hmm. Which makes a lot of difference. Verse 17. And Abraham prayed to Elohim. And Elohim healed Abimelech and his wife and his female servants so that they bore children. Verse 18, final verse. For Yahweh had closed up all the womb of the house of Abimelech because of Sarah, Abraham's wife. So remember he said, I'll kill you and all of your seed after you. Essentially, there would have been no more. Mm-hmm. Right? Mm-hmm. All was forgiven and life continued. Until next time, study to show yourself approved. Mm-hmm. Shalom Aleichem. I like that picture.
Oh, how cute. That makes it all go right off.